Now, we all know smartphones have seen tremendous growth in the past decade. But what kind of growth was it exactly? Let me tell you, it was definitely not gradual or linear. Why we are here today is because certain phones at certain points had a huge impact. They just jumped miles ahead of the competition, inspired the competition, inspired the entire smartphone market to grow along with them. So this video is a roundup of those game-changing smartphones. Let's quickly have a look at them immediately after you subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon, I promise. Earncoro app, our sponsor for this video. All you need to do is download the app, sign up, and share product links with your friends and family. If they make the purchase, you get money. As simple as that. The profit amount is mentioned right here. Don't worry about credibility because the products themselves are from trustworthy sites like Amazon and Flipkart. You can even browse and choose any product of your choice from sites like Flipkart and Amazon, copy the link, paste it in the app, and share the profit link. You can even refer some friends to use this app. If they use your invite code, whenever they make money on Earncoro, you get 10% of it for lifetime. So do check out Earncoro, link in the description. So there are five phones I have in mind, in no particular order. Actually, I think I might have more, but yeah. The first one I want to talk about is the OnePlus One. Budget flagship or value flagship was not even a thing during the start of the decade. But look at where we are right now. True flagships, like those that cost over 70,000-80,000 rupees, they are almost non-existent in terms of market share in India. And on the other hand, OnePlus phones have been the best sellers in the premium category in India. They are comfortably ahead of Samsung's S series, Pixels, Note series, and so on. And brands like LG and Sony are not even in the game anymore. And even a brand like Apple has started providing better value for money phones like the iPhone XR. That was a huge success. And the iPhone 11 is even cheaper than the iPhone XR. And I think the cost for all this is the OnePlus One. That's what started this trend. That's what exposed the consumer's interest in buying phones that are 80% as good as true flagships at just half the price. We also cannot forget the Nexus 4, which came out in 2012, even before the OnePlus One. That was an amazing phone and costed just $300. But Google, for some reason, decided to change the pricing model for the upcoming models, the Nexus 5X, Nexus 6P, and so on. So I don't think it has a lot to do with where we are today. And let's also not forget another thing that OnePlus popularized: fast charging. You know the kind of crazy progress brands have made in that field? 50 watts charging on the 30,000 rupee Realme X2 Pro definitely wouldn't be possible if OnePlus did not popularize fast charging. Next up, Apple iPhone 4 and 5S. The iPhone 4 was way ahead of its time. It's probably my favorite phone of all time. I used it for over 3.5 years. Yes, Apple used to provide such good software support even during those days. It was easily the best phone at the time. It was way ahead of the competition. It had this Retina display with a density of 326 pixels per inch, which was a big deal back then. But funnily, the recently launched iPhone 11 also has the same density of 326 ppi. The iPhone 4 was the only flagship with a glass sandwich design with a metal frame, and despite packing in the best components, it was still the thinnest phone in the market back then. There was a lot to take inspiration from. The iPhone 4 popularized HDR mode. They literally educated the regular consumers, and naturally the consumers expected it from other brands as well. The iPhone 4 also pushed the competition to get rid of cheap plastic on flagships and also come up with high resolution displays. It took a while for Samsung to move from plastic to glass and metal, but it did happen eventually. But none of these things really have a direct impact on what we have today. But the iPhone 5S was a bit different. It was the first phone to come with a 64-bit chip, first phone to come with 120fps HD slow motion capability, and the most important one, Touch ID. Basically, a fingerprint scanner embedded in the home button. The iPhone 5S was not the first phone to come with a fingerprint scanner. but it definitely popularized it, and it definitely had the best implementation. The Galaxy S5, which came after the iPhone 5S, it had a fingerprint scanner, but the implementation was just bad. You had to swipe on the scanner to unlock the phone. Just placing the finger wouldn't work. So the perfect implementation on the iPhone 5S showed the consumers how convenient it was. So 5 years, 6 years later, even in 2020, most of us still prefer a proper fingerprint scanner rather than pattern lock or face unlock or iris scanner. Next, we'll jump to the budget segment for a moment. The Redmi Note 3. What OnePlus did to the value flagship category, Redmi did the same to the budget to mid-range category. At a time when brands were offering terrible chips for the price, the Note 3 came with Snapdragon 650 at just 10,000 rupees. High-end gaming became a reality for budget phone users. Before the Note 3, nobody dreamt of playing games like Asphalt or Modern Warfare on a 10K phone, but the Note 3 changed everything. And if you think about it, in the following years, multiple brands have tried to compete with the Redmi Note series, from Moto to Coolpad, Honor, Huawei, Realme, Leico, do you remember that brand? And even Tenor. And towards the end of the decade, even brands like Samsung and Vivo started coming up with great value for money phones under 15,000 rupees. Samsung's M series and Vivo's Z series are really trying to be up there with the Redmi's and the Realme's. Where did all this start? Redmi Note 3. Truly a game changer in the past decade. I still have one at home. It works fine. It has received a few software updates and the performance is actually surprisingly good even in 2020. Next on the list is a phone that paved the way for bezel-less tech, a phone that pushed other brands and itself to innovate, come up with different solutions to achieve near 100% screen-to-body ratio. Come on, guess the phone. Go comment below, pause the video and go comment. So, it is the Mi Mix by Xiaomi. Yeah, we all know Sharp did it a few years before the Mi Mix. We were like, wow, that's cool. But who's gonna buy a Sharp phone? And Sharp also didn't really come up with many bezel-less phones after that. But when a brand like Xiaomi that believes that everyone needs to get access to the latest innovation comes up with a new design like that, you're gonna take them seriously. And that's what Xiaomi did with the Mi Mix. Like, that was a time when other brands didn't even think about it, didn't even have an idea. None of them thought of increasing the screen real estate without increasing the size of the phone. All Mi Mix phones had truly bezel-less screens with no notch. They all had a chin though. Certain brands, including Xiaomi, were deviated by Apple to offer phones with a huge notch, mostly for marketing purposes. But Xiaomi always put it out there that this would be the end game for flagships. This is what brands needed to achieve. And eventually we started seeing pop-up cameras and sliding mechanisms. Cool, right? A few more phones that deserve to be on this list are the Google Pixel lineup. Their excellent HDR algorithm really made a mark in the field of smartphone photography. They kind of reinforced HDR. So other brands also started giving it a lot more importance. For instance, Apple immediately came up with something called Smart HDR. And of course, how can we forget Night Sight? Night Mode actually existed on some phones before the Pixel 3, I think on the Huawei P20 Pro. But again, it's all about popularizing a feature and making it appear on mainstream phones. And in that aspect, the Pixel lineup is a winner. Similarly, the Galaxy M30 came with an ultra-wide camera, which pushed other brands to offer ultra-wide angle cameras on budget phones, which in turn pushed other brands to offer the same on flagship phones. Before the M30, LG phones were the only mainstream phones to offer ultra-wide angle cameras. We just didn't realize how important they are. But once the M30 and the A50 came out, brands went all guns blazing. We started seeing ultra wide angle cameras on every mainstream phone: Realme XT, Redmi Note 8 Pro, OnePlus 7 Pro, iPhone 11, and so on, Vivo Z1 Pro. And of course, Samsung also deserves a mention for popularizing super slow motion videos. The Galaxy S9 started the trend, and we've been seeing it on a lot of phones, including the OnePlus 7, 7T, 7 Pro, Realme X2 Pro, etc. Some of them use interpolation to get it done, but you see why they're using interpolation, right? Because even if true 960 FPS is not possible, they are doing something to get to 960 FPS because Samsung popularized it and people want it. Now, honorary mention to Galaxy Fold. It's a great concept. I'm not very sure if it's gonna be the future, but if it indeed becomes mainstream, then you would know which phone was the reason. So that's it. Is there anything else I missed? Did any other phone contribute a lot to where the smartphone market stands today? I'm sure I must have missed something, and I'm sure you have something in mind. So let me know in the comment section. This would be super interesting to discuss. That's it. Thanks for watching, and a very happy new year to all of those kind, beautiful souls out there watching this. Hope we all have a great 2020. Take care and bye.